Thanks very much. It's great to be here. And I have to talk inside the box today, so this is a little different than usual. So life is a target. And what does that mean? Well, I was at a conference a few years ago, and the subject was emerging threats in cyberspace. And I kept hearing the same things that I'd been facing for 10 or 15 years. And it occurred to me that there really were not emerging threats so much as there were emerging targets. And that's a big difference. So I spent my life as a target. When you talk about being a target, you need to worry about who is targeting you. And the model for who's targeting you, you need to consider those things on the slide. The resources they can bring to bear and the capabilities they have. So sometimes you're able to do something, sometimes you can't, but you can buy it. So what resource do you have? What's the intent and motivation? What do you want to do? Why do you want to do it? What kind of access do you have? And what kind of risk aversion do you have? Those are the important characteristics. I'm going to talk about those things throughout the talk. Now, back in the good old days when I started, it really was a one-on-one game. It was us and the Soviet Union. And it was kind of great. I remember first day when I went into NSA, I was sitting with a bunch of young people, first day on board, and we were 21 to 25. There was an old guy in the back, and that probably means he was about 30. But you know, everything's relative. So after 2 days there, he came up to us. He said, "Now, I want you all to know," and he was standing up the front, "I want you all to know that you are targets. Right? You guys have clearances. You're going to be working on crypto. You're a prime target for the Soviet Union. So, you know, you be careful. Live carefully. Don't give them an opportunity." He said, "You know, if you go to a bar and a good-looking guy, good-looking girl comes up and talks to you, be careful. It's not because you're interesting. I've spent 2 days with you. You're not." You know, it reminds me of the joke. The mathematician gets invited to a party. That was a joke. So that's what you keep in mind. You have to live your life that way. The nice thing about it was we had rules back then. And the Soviets and the Americans, same goals, same rules. I was a target. My family was not a target. No one's going to come up and kidnap me. They're going to give me the opportunity to do something stupid, and then they'll take advantage of that. If you look at the world at that time, it was basically espionage, the Cold War was espionage, and the technology race. Technology race was, it was really nuclear weapons. Space race a little bit, but nuclear weapons was what we cared about. Now the neat thing about nuclear weapons was, if somebody drops a bomb on you, you know where it came from, particularly back then, because we weren't dropping bombs on ourselves, so it had to come from Russia. And it wasn't the local Russian high school. It was going to be state-sponsored. So attribution was really pretty easy. The fun part for us was the espionage. It was a great game, and you knew what you were trying to get. You were trying to get strategic U.S. government information. It wasn't personal. They didn't care about my bank account. They would care about my bank account if it was overdrawn, because that would give them access to me as a target. So that's what they were looking for, some way in, something they could take advantage of. Gambling, if you needed money, that kind of thing. But the world was very symmetric. We were looking for the same things. We had the same capabilities, the same intent, the same motivation. We wanted to know what we were doing. It's a different world today. So if you think about attacks back then, attacks were very well planned out. They were intricate, and they were lasting. They had about one a decade. So you think of Walker. Walker was a guy who was in the military. He was a crypto custodian, so he had access to crypto variables. We used crypto to protect ourselves back then, and crypto was good. It was rock solid. We knew what people would try to take advantage of, and we tried to make sure they couldn't. So if you look at an example of Vinson, it's a handheld radio. It was designed in the 50s. And it was first fielded in 1976. went through a bunch of different versions where we looked at the implementation. I went through the engineering diagrams for Vincent and looked at every gate, every register, every line to see what could go wrong and make sure that nothing bad happened. And anything bad that was going to happen, we alarmed to make sure that, it didn't happen. 20 years later, we fielded it. Now, that Vincent is still in the field today. So 76 to today, we haven't changed one thing about it. It's not like today's operating systems that change on Tuesdays. It's a different world. Those things were rock solid. Now, they relied on the crypto variable for security, and that's why Walker was a great target. We assumed that the Russians knew what the machines looked like. They knew everything but the crypto variable. Pretty good assumption. I was talking to one of my buddies from the FBI one time. He said, hey, you know, and this was back in the early 70s, he said, there's an offer of $1 million for the first Vincent that gets delivered to the Russian embassy. And 2 weeks later, he called me up and said, that offer's off the table. So, assume they got one. That's the kind of thing we were facing. And the other thing, of course, is we did share equipment with some of our friends. Some of our friends were not really all that good friends. You know, it might be Iran or somebody like that, where they would have these equipments. We pretty much knew that we couldn't trust them for too long. So that's the kind of thing we are. But Walker had access to crypto variables, and he could sell them. So he did. Now, part of the rule was Walker needed money. He was a good target. They got him. They wouldn't have gone after him if he wasn't a good target. The Great Seal. Are you familiar with the Great Seal, where the kids gave the president the Great Seal? It had a recording device in it. If you want to see that, it's in the museum over by Fort Meade. Gunman. I don't know if you're familiar with Gunman or not. Gunman is kind of it's a neat example. Turns out that if you look at our crypto, back then you had to go through crypto. You couldn't go around crypto. We made sure of that. So if you look at the embassy, the way they operated was they would type out a classified message, take it down to the room where it was to be transmitted. It would be entered into the crypto machine and transmitted out as cipher. Anybody can get cipher. Now that's free. You can have it. But you got to go through the crypto to understand what it says. Well, it turns out that we relied on the Soviets to do some cleaning and things like that inside the embassy. And those typewriters kept kind of breaking down. They weren't as robust as we would have liked. And we did a little look at them a few years later. And if you know what a typewriter looks like, there's a triangular support bar under the keyboard. Those bars had been replaced by bars that had been hollowed out, and a transmitter and a recorder had been inserted in it. So they were recording and transmitting the contents of those messages. That was declassified, I think, about 2 years ago. So it's Gunman, if you're interested. It's a pretty neat report. We took tons of equipment out, and that's all we found. But the technology that was in those typewriters was really cool. So that got them a lot of information. You know about the State Department chair rail case? They found that there was a piece of chair rail between a wall and a door that had been replaced, and it had been hollowed out and put in a transmitter. They found that out by, it was a DC policeman who saw something funny going on. He was watching a car outside the State Department, and there was a Russian, and he was doing something that was very suspicious. He was putting quarters in the parking meter. Russians don't do that. They have diplomatic immunity. It's almost a game with them. There's a guy down there who has 3,000 parking tickets. That's a parking ticket a day for 10 years. How do you do that? Because you don't get tickets on Sunday. So I mean, the guy must drive around looking for policemen who are giving tickets. But anyway, this guy was putting quarters in. So the policeman watched him for a little while. And every once in a while, he'd reach around and he'd adjust a box of Kleenex in the window, the back of the car. And he figured, this doesn't make a whole lot of sense. So he called the FBI in, and they found the recording device was, in fact, in that box of Kleenex. So that's the kind of thing that happens. But that's an attack on a target inside the State Department, and that's really fair. That's a fine thing to do. Now, the world has completely changed. What do we have? You know, money is now plastic. So it used to be if you were robbed, you'd lose the money in your wallet. Now you lose the credit card, you could lose a lot more. Think of the values of big companies. Back in the 70s, a big company was General Motors. The value was in its equipment, its inventory, its steel. Hard stuff for someone to take. If you look at a company like Google today, the value is in bits. And those bits are constantly going out. That's a problem. The threat adversary model is very much the same, but the game is very much asymmetric. It used to be the defense was hard and offense was hard. We really had to struggle to make headway in offense back then. You can see how hard it is to find a guy like Walker, how much you have to work to replace equipment in typewriters in an embassy. That's hard to do. Today's world, you send somebody a fake email. There's risk involved in going after a Walker. If you're a Soviet in this country trying to talk somebody into giving you secrets, if that person decides not to do it, you're going to be turned in. If somebody sends you a bad email, what happens to them? Absolutely nothing. So the risk has been taken out of the game. When it was us and the Soviet Union, that was one-on-one. How many countries are there today that can run a cyber attack? Lots can run sophisticated cyber attacks. Lots more can run simple ones. If you want to know how to do it, you can read on the internet how to do it. So in today's world, it's not just a person like me who's a target, but my family is a target. Your families are targets. Kids are targets. My parents are targets. It's a completely different game, and we aren't used to living our life that way. When I was a target of the Soviet Union, somebody spoke to me in an airplane. First thing I thought was, is he Russian? And part of the rule was not that they would identify themselves. In fact, part of the game is to lie. And they might say, you know, you guys are doing all this stuff, and it's really good. The American people need to know about this. If you give me the information, I can let the people know about part of it, and it'll be good for the country, it'll be good for the Department of Defense, and instead it goes back to the Soviet Union. And that's a valid way to do it. Or, you know, I know you're of whatever ancestry. You could really help that country if you wanted. That kind of thing does happen. It's not like today's world. In today's world, we're all targets. You might think of it as if when you're crossing a street out here, the drivers are very well behaved. When that light turns, you're perfectly safe to walk out. That's not a good model for the internet. See, in the internet, when that light changes, half the cars out there are going to try to run you over as you cross the street. We don't live our lives that way. We've got to learn to do that. The problem is, you can't teach everybody how to live their lives that way. And we have shared risks. Everybody on your network shares that risk. And when I think of that Vincent, there was a guy out in the field, you know, his life was to do two things: stay alive and complete the mission. Everything else he did was a risk management decision. Whenever he made one of those decisions, he was sharing that risk with the six other guys on his net. Now, there wasn't a whole lot he could do with the setting on that Vincent to screw anything up. He had to choose one of six crypto variables, he had to turn it on or off, and he had to put it in cipher mode, and then he had to push the button to talk. That's pretty easy. Today's world, a lot of times you've got a laptop out there instead of a Vincent. Very different game. There are a lot more things you can do with that laptop to cause yourself trouble. And you're sharing that risk with a lot more people. That's if you remember Buckshot Yankee, that was the problem. Some people made some risk management decisions. They didn't go so well. That's the life that we face right now. The kids, I used to tell everybody that we have to educate the end user and make sure they know that there's a risk. Well, I think that's been done. I don't think that there are many end users that are uneducated right now about the risk. And if they are, it's because they're 3 years old and they like to look at animals, and you're not going to really make them aware of that risk. Scott Charney likes to tell a story about he's part of a Sanders generation. He says he has a four-year-old at home who loves to look at the little videos of animals, cute kittens, cute puppies. Every once in a while, a little pop-up shows up with a button on it. So he looks at it for about 3 seconds. He hits OK, because he knows if he does that, he gets to look at more pictures of animals. He said his, at the same time, his mother's a retired professor. She does a lot of traveling. She likes to go to the sites to see what she's going to see, what kind of shopping there is, what kind of entertainment. Every once in a while, one of these little things shows up on the screen. And so he said he watched her. And she slowly gets closer and closer to the screen. Like if she gets close enough, it's going to make sense. So after about 2 minutes, she shrugs and hits OK. She at least could read, so she knew what the words said. The four-year-old can't even read. But she didn't know what to do with the words. You know, we're never going to make a four-year-old or my parents smart enough that they're going to be able to really protect themselves from a nation-state type attack. And hackers out there that are trying to take advantage of people are as good as nation-states. They're good. So what are you going to do? It's got to fall on the professionals. The professionals have to take care of the people. That's us. There are so many adversaries out there. Their intent and motivation is no longer to go after strategic information from the government. It's to go after all the government information, whether it's Department of Agriculture, Department of Commerce, NASA, all that information. Now, the best thing they can do with that information is take it. The worst thing they can do with that information is change it. And that's the problem we're going to be facing in the future. Because when they start changing that information, that's a problem. I'm not worried about somebody taking the stock exchange down. Wall Street, they're not going to do that. They can make some money by getting early information. What I'm worried about is the integrity of sales. Because if people lose confidence in their ability to make sales, to have good communications, good secure communications, then the stock market's in trouble. Look what's been happening. We used to have about one attack a decade. Now we have, in 2011, we had 41,000 attacks against the government. 41,000. These are attacks. These are not pings. These are attacks. McAfee said they're getting 60,000 unique pieces of malware a day. How do you keep up? And it's not just us. RSA, Lockheed Martin, NASDAQ, Mitsubishi, DigiNotar. These are important. Not to mention all the credit card information that's going out the window constantly. Health system, it's part of Johns Hopkins. We have to worry about that, and I'm worried about it. Yeah. The same system that people can get access to are controlling people's lives. That's not a good situation. What are we going to do about that? Well, it's going to rely on the next generation to solve that problem. Technology makes life easier for the bad guys. It can make life easier for the good guys. And the shared risk, we've got to understand that we're all sharing this risk. So let me tell you a little story about shared risk that kind of sums up life as a target for me. Back in, it was about 2000, the director of NSA was going to go to Black Hat and give a lunchtime keynote. So he asked me to give him some talking points, which his speechwriters would turn into a speech. Now I did that. And I thought it turned out to be a pretty darn good speech. And about a week before, I got a call from his exec. It said, the director would like you to give the speech in his place. And I said, you know, the people at Black Hat are going to be a little disappointed when they expect a guy with a lot of stars on his shoulders to come out on stage and they get me. And they said, no, we've already squared it with them. They're ready for you to come. I said, why? And they said, well, you have to call Kemp. So I called Kemp. I said, Kemp, what's up? And he said, well, you know, we've got some very good information that if the director shows up, there's going to be an assassination attempt. So So he said, so we met and we talked about it, and we decided you're not that good a target. No. And that's life as a target. Thanks very much.
Thank you.